Good morning. We welcome you all to the Sunday morning worship service. Let's acknowledge God through a word of prayer. Dear loving Father, in whose name we have gathered here, Lord, we thank you and we've come here to glorify your name. Lord, we pray that you forgive our sins and hear us as we worship and call out to your name, Lord. Father, as we find strength and comfort in you, Lord, help us go through the coming days by resting in your presence, Lord. Teach us to walk with you and be with us and guard us. Amen. Isaiah 40:31 says, strength will rise as we wait on the Lord. We will mount with wings like eagles, and we will rise with strength of an eagle. And we will run and not grow weary. We will walk and not faint. My friends, wherever you are today, whether you are running, whether you are walking, let's ask God to provide us with strength by resting in His place. Redeem means to save, to regain, and to retrieve. Our God is such a wonderful God that He saved us from our sins. He retrieves the lost strength. He regains the time. Let's confess through the next song that we believe, because all He asks for us is to believe in Him.
I love you, rescue my soul.
The Lord, O my soul. The entire chapter talks about blessing the Lord for His sovereignty, blessing the Lord for His loving kindness, blessing the Lord for His grace and for everything, for His benefits. Isn't it beautiful that we end every prayer this way? Let's end this worship session by singing the last song, Blessed Be the Name of the Lord.
To the worship service this morning. May the Lord Almighty meet us as we participate in this worship service and reveal His mind and purpose to us through His holy words, and also fill our hearts with His divine presence, so that we may have this precious moment as a wonderful gift from His hands, and also along with that we may receive all the blessings that He wants to shower upon us. May we all close our eyes and join in the prayer. Almighty and ever-living God, we praise and thank You, Lord, for this wonderful opportunity and privilege that You have granted us to worship You this morning. We have tasted how much loving You are in our lives, and You have given us another opportunity to taste and experience Your love for us. Lord, we thank You that You have brought us all together and bound us all in Your spirit, so that unitedly we may worship You this morning. Inspire us and encourage us so that we may offer a meaningful and sincere worship service to Your glory this morning. In Jesus' matchless and precious name, we say this prayer. Amen. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him, bless His name. For the Lord is good, His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand. O that today you would listen to His voice. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in the holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against Him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by following His laws, which He set before us by His servants, the prophets. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, You will not despise. Jesus said, come to Me, all ye that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. I will get up and go to My Father, and I will say to Him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before You. Let the words of My mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to You, O Lord, My Rock and My Redeemer. Amen. Dear friends, we have come here in the presence of God to examine our hearts and realize our shortcomings and faults, and also search our hearts and know our rebellious nature against God. So this is the time granted to us to introspect within ourselves and bring all our shortcomings, failures and sins in the presence of God, so that we may receive forgiveness from His gracious arms. May we all remain in silence for a moment. Almighty God, we have come to Your presence to offer You, through our Lord Jesus Christ, our worship and thanksgiving. Help us to make a true confession of sins and to pray for others as well as for ourselves. Grant that by our listening to Your holy word, we may know more truly the greatness of Your love and show forth in our lives the fruits of Your grace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will He keep His anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is His steadfast love towards those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, So far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquities and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain in me a willing spirit. Grant, we ask you, merciful Lord, to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now the scriptural portion for this occasion, for this morning, is taken from the book, the Second Samuel, chapter 9, verses 1 to 13. 2 Samuel, chapter 9, verses 1 to 13. And David said, "Is there still anyone left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. And they called him to David. And the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" And he said, "I am your servant." And the king said, "Is there not still someone of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God to him?" Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is a crippled in his feet." The king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "He is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, a low Debar." Then King David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel. And Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David and fell on his face and paid homage. And David said, "Mephibosheth." And he answered, "Behold, I am your servant." And David said to him, "Do not fear, for I will show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan, and I will restore you all the land of Saul your father, and you shall eat at my table always." And he paid homage and said, "What is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I?" Then the king called Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, "All that belonged to Saul and to all his house I have given your master's grandson. And you and your sons and your servants shall till the land for him and shall bring in the produce, that your master's grandson may have bread to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's grandson, shall always eat at my table." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "According to all that my lord the king commands his servant, so will your servant do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah, and all who lived at Ziba's house became Mephibosheth's servants. So Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, for he ate always at the king's table. Now he was lame in both his feet. Here ends the reading from the scripture. Thanks be to you, O God. Maybe you all join in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now may we all sing to the glory of God the hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Thank you.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Friends, this day is considered to be the day for the disabled, the day for the disabled people. The theme given to us by the diocese is concern for the disabled people. Disability is a very serious problem that hurts people. And we see several people who are disabled in so many ways. There is blindness, there is paralysis, there is deafness, there are so many other ailments related to the physical disablement. Those days, such people are called handicapped people. That is a very crude term to address or to call anybody. In fact, they are not handicapped, they are differently able. So, the modern society has changed the terminology and calls them differently able people. That is a very appropriate way to call them. They are able in different way. They are able in different way. And they are called invalid people because the society considers them to be not valid for anything. The society considers them to be less productive. Therefore, this should be our concern these days. When we walk on the street, when we travel in transports, we see many, many disabled people around us. We see many blind people, many people with hearing, with deafness, people with spastic problem, people with mental instability, people who cannot move because of the paralytic attack, and so many disabilities we find in the society. But unfortunately, we pass them, without even taking note of them. We tend to neglect them, we tend to ignore them. But these are the people who are carrying a lot of pain within their hearts. Not only these people, the members of their family also suffer a lot of pain to see the members of their family suffering some kind of disability. And therefore, through this scriptural portion that we have heard this morning, we are called to reflect about our attitude towards such people. And if there is a correction, if there is any correction needed in our approach to them, we must immediately correct ourselves and we must have a different approach to them. You see, the disabled people are considered to be less productive, dull, not considered for any job opportunities, not favored for competitive assignments. Disablement is a disqualification to exercise priestly office. Very interesting to note that even in priestly office in the Old Testament period, any disablement was considered to be a disqualification for anybody to be considered to carry out the priestly ministry. You see, Leviticus chapter 21 verse 16 to 23, the word of God says, "No one who has a blemish shall draw near the altar, a man blind or lame, or one who has a mutilated face, or a limb too long, or a man who has injured foot or hand, or a hunchback, or a dwarf." Such people were not to be considered to carry out the priestly ministry. So this reflects the understanding of the Old Testament time, the olden days. And those days, any disability, was considered to be an act of punishment, divine punishment. They did something wrong, therefore God punished them so that they are disabled people, handicapped people now, differently abled people. You know, and it was also cursed as a divine curse, considered as a divine curse. So disability in those days was considered as a divine curse or a divine punishment. For example, Genesis chapter 19, verse 11, we find the two angels who were sent by God to the Sodom, you know, they were inside the house of Lot, and the people of Sodom surrounded the house, and they were knocking at the door violently, scaring the people inside. And that was the time we see verse 11, Genesis chapter 19, verse 11, the angels struck them blind, and therefore they all went blind. And also Elisha, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 18 to 20, Elisha and his servant were together, and the servant saw the army of Syrians surrounding the city. And Elisha prayed to God that he may strike the people with blindness. That was the prayer of Elisha. 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 18 to 20. Strike these people with blindness, O Lord. That was the prayer. And immediately the Lord struck them blind, and they all went blind. So it was considered to be an act of divine punishment. Samson, for example, you see Samson, Judges chapter 14, verse 2, and he says, I have seen a Philistine woman at Timnah, now get her for marry me as my wife. That is what he says to his parents. I have seen a woman, a Philistine woman at Timnah, and arrange a marriage with her for me. And if you just go still down at that scriptural portion, we see the Philistines, you know, bound him, you know, towards the pillar, and they plucked his eyes. You see, God allowed this to happen. He said, I saw a Philistine girl and fell in love with her. And his eyes were plucked by the Philistines. So that was considered, that these two events have a close relation or contact, you know. It was considered to be a divine punishment. See, in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse 19, we see King Uzziah, he became very proud, and he tried to enter into the altar to burn incense. The Azariah, the priest, prevents him, but still he was very, very persistent in going inside and burned the incense. And the divine anger fell upon him. And the word of God says in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse 19, leprosy broke out on his forehead. He became a leper. And also we see paralysis. See, I was saying, you know, some, you know, blindness, deafness, leprosy. Paralysis is another serious disability. And we see in 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 4, the king Jeroboam, he was at the altar at the Bethel, and there was a prophet who came and prophesied against the king. So the king became very angry, and he stretched forth his hand, commanding the soldiers to catch the prophet. The moment he stretched forth his hand became very rigid. And the word of God says, it became dried up, and he could not withdraw the hand back. 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 14. So all these references that we have seen talk about the disablement getting connected with some sort of divine punishment or divine curse. So that was the belief of the people of the Old Testament period. Even today, many have that kind of belief. When they see somebody who are disabled, they immediately say that they have sinned. It is because of the sin that they have committed, or it is because of the sin that the person's parents have committed, or the forefathers have committed. One, you see, it is on with this background The disciples of Jesus put a question before Jesus. John's Gospel, chapter 9, verse 1 to 3. You know, there was a blind man that Jesus healed at Jerusalem. And John's Gospel, chapter 9, verse 1 to 3, the disciples asked, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" So they also carried a similar, you know, similar thinking, similar idea that handicappedness or disability is the result of a sin that was committed by the individual or committed by the members of the family, either parents or others. So this is the false idea that the society has towards such people. You see, then look at the answer of Jesus to the disciples. He said, "It was not this man or his parents who have sinned, but that the works of the Lord might get displayed in him." So Jesus had a different idea, different approach towards a man with disability. He says it is not because of this man committed sin or his parents committed sin, because the name of the Lord will be glorified through this person. This man is disabled now. So Jesus had a different approach towards such people. You know, in Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, again we see a situation where the disciples asked, put a question before Jesus. You know, they heard a news that Pilate killed a few Galileans because they tried to follow Jesus, because they were followers of Jesus. And Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, verse 1, "The Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices." The Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifice. This was one incident. The Galileans were killed by Pilate for no reason at all. And in verse 4, Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, verse 4, again, another incident was reported to Jesus. 18 people, you know, on whom the tower at Siloam fell. Tower at Siloam fell on about people, and 18 people were dead. They died out of this. And the disciples again took this incident to Jesus and said, "These people died because did they commit any sin? Was it because they suffered a divine punishment that they had to lose their life?" And Jesus said, "You know, do you think they were worse offenders than all others who lived in Jerusalem?" Jesus turns the coin. He puts the question back to them. "Do you think those who live in Jerusalem are righteous people or people without any sin?" So therefore, Jesus had completely different attitude towards such people who were suffering with various disablement. And what is the need of the disabled people? What is the need? We have seen that how the society looked at these people in those days. Now there is a change, and there should be a change in the attitude of the people towards such people who are suffering from various kind of disablement. And what is their need? Their need is that they need love from others. You know, they are already discouraged. They are already downhearted. You know, and the immediate need for them was love from others, is love from others. They are neglected and despised people, and they long to experience love of others. That is what we should offer them. We as the members of the church, we as the followers of Jesus Christ, are called to shower our love upon such people. Unfortunately, we don't have any concern for them. Even if we see them, we just simply pass by them. And we don't really be stirred in our hearts. And you know, we simply pass them. The Word of God says, the Bible teaches us that such people should be shown our love and affection. You see, there is one example, classic example I want to really share with you. The scriptural portion that was read to us this morning was from 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1 to 13. See, the family, the kingdom of Saul fell down, and David emerged as the leader of Israel. And when David became king, you know, he looked for the members of the family, anybody left from the family of Saul. And while he looked for them, it was informed to them that there was one boy by name Mephibosheth, a son of Jonathan, a close friend of David. And this boy was invalid, and he suffered a serious injury in his feet and unable to walk. So he was considered to be an invalid and a handicapped person. So the moment David knew about it, he sent word for that boy, Mephibosheth, and whatever, you know, he did to him, that was, we read from that scriptural portion that we heard from the Bible this morning. There he says, "I loved your father so much. Now I hear that you are in this state. Now I will restore all the fortunes of your family, your forefathers, and also you will share with me in the dining table. So you will be with me and share your fellowship with me as my family enjoys food at the dining table." See, just imagine what kind of emotional, you know, support this man would have received from King David. He definitely received, you know, the king's love, the king's concern. And we read in the Bible that, you know, the king ordered the servant Ziba, servant of Saul, that the land that he is going to restore to Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the family will enjoy the fruits of the yield of the land, but Ziba will eat at the table along with the king. See, look at the way how wonderfully David was sharing his love for this person. This should be our attitude also. We are called to show our love for such people. If it happens, such people will be encouraged more in their lives. They will taste the love of others in their own lives, and they will be encouraged, they will be emboldened to lead a very confident life, lead their life confidently. The second thing, and also you see the love and compassion, love and concern for such people. There are so many incidents we can quote from the ministry of Jesus Christ. Matthew's Gospel chapter 15 verse 30 and 31 says, "Blind and lame came to him, and he healed them." They were given the first priority in his ministry. Luke's Gospel chapter 14 verse 12 to 14 says, "He invited the poor and the crippled." Mark's Gospel chapter 10 verse 46 says, "He heard the cry of the blind man Bartimaeus." While the disciples were restricting him, were stopping him not to cry for Jesus, but Jesus stopped there and attended to his need. Luke's Gospel chapter 8 verse 43 to 48, "Women with issue of blood, Jesus healed her, and immediately she brought her to the limelight so that she could continue to enjoy, you know, the social life." You know, she was restored back to the society. So that was the ministry of Jesus. So we need to follow the footsteps of Jesus by showering and showing our love to such people. The second thing is restoration of self-esteem. These people consider themselves as people who are nobodies in the society. Nobody bothers about them. Nobody cares for them. But they really need restoration of self-esteem. They need to be respected. They need to be treated properly. You know, Mephibosheth calls himself a dead dog. You know, in 2 Samuel chapter 9 verse 8, he says, "What is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I?" That is how he considered himself. But King David restored his esteem, you know, his self-esteem was restored. And the king says in verse 7, "You shall eat at my table always." Look at the way he treats the other person, the handicapped person, the person with serious disability. He was given the privilege of eating with the royal family. So the self-esteem was restored. This is another important requirement of the disabled people. They need to be respected. They need to be treated properly. The third thing is that God identifies himself with such people. It's quite interesting to see that God identifies with such people more than others. You see, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 40 to 42 says, "Whoever receives you receives me." God identifies himself with his people, and more so with people who are with disabilities. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, verse 40, "Whatever you have done to the least of my brothers, you have done it to me. Whatever you have not done to them, you have not done to me." Which these verses say that God identifies himself with such people. So we are also called to identify ourselves with such people, not to distance ourselves from them. You know, Jesus' identification with such people, you know, we find in the Bible that when Jesus was nailed on the cross, his hands were pierced, his legs were pierced. If Jesus had to live even after that cruel experience, he would not have been able to walk properly, because his hands were pierced, his legs were pierced, his ribs were pierced, and he showed his hands, pierced hands and feet, to the disciples, which means he was also disabled. He was made to suffer disability by the unjust religious and political leaders. So the disability happens, you know, most of the times because of the unjust social structure, not because of their fault. You know, it is said that, you know, if close relatives get married, the children who will be born will be affected. They will suffer some sort of, serious problems, you see. So it is advised medically the close relatives not to get married. See, unjust social system and the air pollution, the water pollution, is considered to be main reason for causing so many disabilities among the people who live in the society. You know, paralysis, lung infection are the result of the air pollution, result of the water pollution. And therefore, many are made invalid because of the unjust society. And Jesus was made invalid. You know, I would like to use this word under quote. Invalid, because he suffered, his hands were pierced and his legs were pierced, his ribs were pierced. He also suffered and he became a disabled person, you know, during the crucifixion by the unjust social structure, religious structure. And so we have to stand against such oppressive social political structures that we face in this world. You know, Jesus identifies himself more and more with such people. He showed his disciples his pierced hands and pierced legs, and which shows that he was also a sufferer of disability caused by the society, unjust social structure, unjust religious structure, unjust political structure. Therefore, we need to be more identified with such people. How can we show our love to them? We can pray for them. We can share our resources with them. These people are very much in financial need. and we can consider extending our financial help to such people. There are so many homes which take care of such people. If possible, we can also visit such homes and share our love with them. And may the Lord Almighty continue to speak to us and encourage us so that we may follow Him faithfully, follow His footsteps in His way of showering His love for such unfortunate people, the people who are suffering with various kinds of inabilities, handicappedness. May the Lord Almighty bless this devotion to all of us this morning. Amen. Let us pray. Let's pray for global peace. O God, who is the author of peace and lover of concord, in whose knowledge our eternal life stands, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, your humble servants, from all assaults of evil, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. O Lord, our refuge, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with your mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by your governance, to do always that which is righteous in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God of all mercies, we are unworthy servants, give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your boundless love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we ask you, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Father God, we bring to your hands all those who are suffering from various kind of invalidness. The society treats them badly. They are branded as handicapped people. But Lord, you have taught us to have a different look and approach towards them, Master. They are no more handicapped people. They are people with different abilities. And therefore help us, dear Master, as you have taught us through your holy words, to treat them well, to shower our love upon them, and to share our resources with them in their need, and also to treat them in a dignified manner, so that they may also lead a life with full respect, and also a life of dignity and self-esteem. We pray for the homes which accommodate such people, the home for the physically impaired people, the home for the visually impaired people, the home for the school, the home for the deaf and people suffering from hearing impairment, and people who are affected with paralysis, polio disorder, and so many ailments, dear Master. And we place in your hands all the homes who take care of them and those who administer such homes, dear Master. Grant your wisdom to them and pour your compassion in their hearts so that they may render their service to such people in such a way that all their needs will be met and they may have a life of abundance, dear Master. Thank you for being with us all through the worship service. And thank you, Lord, for sending your blessings upon us abundantly. In Jesus' matchless and wonderful name, we say this prayer. Amen. Unto God's most gracious mercy and protection we commit all of us this moment. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Now may we all join together in the hymn, stand up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus. Let us depart in peace. In the name of the Lord. Amen.